Okay. Dobar dan svima, hvala vam što ste došli. Ovo je Filippo Valguarnera, pošto će seminar biti održan na engleskom, sada ćemo se prebaciti na engleski. So, hello everyone and welcome. Filippo Valguarnera is the professor of law in the University of Gothenburg in Sweden. He has been studying in many places, mostly in Italy, but also in New York and in Sweden. And his main teaching fields are private law, legal history, EU law, comparative law. More prominently, he has been one of the coordinators of the projects on access to commons with Ugo Mattei and Saki Bailey. What is the specific reason why we wanted to hear what Filippo has to say on commons is that he has been dedicating big part of his research to right to roam and access to land, which are a peculiar aspect of our legal systems that show a big difference to the to what we consider that is the main purpose of the legal system and what is its mainstream paradigm. This has been recognized as a part of commons now, and it has opened up with other things the debate on what is the relation between law and commons, and whether within this relation we might find something important in shifting the paradigm in the societies of today. So without further ado, Filippo, please.
Thank you very much, and thank you all for being here, and thank you for the very kind invitation, and thank you for sharing the weather with me, because I come from pretty cold country. I mean, it's warm for our usual temperatures, but it's still 4 degrees and raining. Here we have 16 degrees, and I feel a little bit tanned and pretty nice after a walk in this beautiful city. It's my first visit in Belgrade, so I'm especially grateful for the opportunity. And as Sasha was saying, I am of Italian origin, in the sense that I grew up in Italy, but with a Swedish mother. So as soon as the Italian universities started collapsing because of economic restraint, and also because I actually met my wife in Sweden, so the two good reasons, I moved away from Italy and to Sweden. My story with the commons, which is the topic of today, started in relationship with Sweden, actually. It started when I was finishing my bachelor degree in law at the University of Florence in Italy. And one day I followed a friend who was moving into an apartment. I followed him to IKEA, which of course, as you know, is the embassy of Sweden in the world, the official embassy. That's where we spread Swedish culture. So we entered the IKEA, and there was a huge sign promoting something called Allemansrätten, which roughly can be translated as the right of all, or even more specifically, the right of all men, which essentially is the right of every person to enter onto private land, to pick mushrooms or take a walk, even plant a tent and stay there for about 24 hours, or take a bath in a lake, and so on and so forth. So I got very fascinated by this, because in Italy I've never heard of it, and by my mother I had a vague recollection of what it was. I quickly discovered that Swedes were very passionate about it, and I also discovered that they were pretty proud about it. So I thought, well, this is a nice topic for a possible doctoral dissertation. And well, you encounter your ideas in the most improbable places. My encounter was in IKEA. I'm not very proud of it, but one should be honest. In writing about this topic, and in writing it from a comparative point of view, in the sense that I wanted to see how these possibilities whether these possibilities in fact existed in other legal systems, and if they didn't exist in other legal systems, the possibilities of entering in someone else's land and using it, I wanted to understand why they didn't exist. And I wanted to understand it both in terms of the present legal system, but also historically. How had these legal systems developed? The Swedish one, the Norwegian one, the English one, the French one, the Italian one, why had they developed in such different ways? And in doing this kind of studies, I encountered the notion of commons, of which I was completely ignorant. I had ever heard it during my whole course of studies, so I started studying them from scratch. And this is in part what I want to talk about, because I think this is relevant for the topic at hand. Why? I'm not going to spend many words discussing what the commons are, because I understand that most of you have a good knowledge. I won't bother you or bore you by recollecting what you already well know. But what is interesting, I think, in this tale I'm trying to transmit to you now is that for a whole course of studies, 4.5 years in an Italian university, I never ever encountered the term commons. And let me give you another anecdote to start to elucidate why this topic that I'm picked for this evening might be of interest. When I, many years later, I worked at the Swedish University and was invited by a very learned scholar, a friend of mine, to a conference, he said, well, you can pick whatever topic you want, as long as it's sort of original and we want to hear something new. And I said, well, I could talk about the commons. And bear, I mean, this scholar is not an ignoramus. This is a pretty good legal theoretician. He's more open than most to new ideas. And his automatic reply was, what do you mean? The House of Commons? Are you going to talk about English constitutional law? No, and I started to explain, and he was very fascinated by the whole idea. And this tells you one thing which I think is pretty interesting, that in the field of law, today, as we speak, commons, the idea of the commons, is pretty foreign. I'm not suggesting that scholars, legal scholars, are antagonistic to the idea of the commons. In a sense, I would prefer if that was the case, because if you have an antagonism, if you have an aggression against an idea, then you can defend that idea with arguments and you can have a discussion, preferably a fruitful one. The problem here is not aggression, it's complete indifference. It's not in their I'm talking about as if I was not part of the pack, but I am actually a jurist. So it's not in our radar, with some very important exceptions, which I will discuss. The major exception is the field of intellectual property, and I will discuss a few reasons for it being an exception in this. But what I think is interesting here is that if I instead go to my colleagues at the Department of Economy at my home university in Gothenburg, or if I talk to sociologists, or if I go talk to philosophers, political philosophers, or if I go talking to cultural geographers, even if they don't work in the field of the commons, they know what it is. It's often a major component of contemporary research. We know very well that the paradigm of the tragedy of the commons was problematized, and I would not say debunked, but hugely problematized and criticized by in the field of economics by Elinor Ostrom, who won a Nobel Prize for it. So in fields outside of the law, in social fields, social sciences outside of law, commons is not a mysterious word. When you take a step into the realm of law, suddenly commons are left very much outside. Now, one could say, well, why are you talking about with us about your domestic problems in the field of law? If your friends, the jurists, are a bunch of uneducated barbarians, go and talk to them, which is a perfectly legitimate reaction. Why I suggest that this problem is wider and broader and should engage not only me as a jurist, but other people as well, is that law, whether we like it or not, whether we appreciate the idea or not, is a form of social interface. I've been to many commons conferences with marvelous activists with fantastic ideas. I've talked about commons with economists, with philosophers, and so on and so forth. But, and I mean, this is a debatable idea, but my point of departure here, at least, is that very little can be realized in the world of actual building of institutions. Very little can be done to truly change the way society work if you don't have lawyers on board, or at least if you don't have part of the legal culture on board, because that is, whether we like it or not, in Western culture, the interface between action, the theoretical level and the operational level. And there is also another reason. If we discuss commons, especially if we discuss commons from the perspective which I think has had the strongest impact in all of social sciences, which is the impact, the behavioral economics kind of perspective, it's pretty obvious in their writings that rules play a strong role in determining if a commons will work or not. That is clear already in the writings of Elinor Ostrom. If you ask Douglas North, what is institutional economics, which is the basis on which Elinor Ostrom work? Well, institutions are the rule of the game. You can disagree with that definition or not, but it's pretty clear that to many scholars involved in the discussion about commons, rules, for many of these scholars, rules should be pretty important, are pretty important. But interestingly enough, very few of these scholars think of trying to involve jurists who actually specialize in rules in the discussion. And the result is, I suggest, a strange kind of intellectual horizon where you have a huge activity or a very strong activity in the field of commons, both scholarly and politically, but a very weak understanding of the commons from a legal perspective, from the perspective of those whose work is actually to work with rules, whose work is actually to try to shape, or should be to shape, the rules of the society we live in. So I've tried I will try in this lecture to elucidate why this, this gap exists between jurists and the commons. And I will try also to end with some optimism, because I believe in optimism rather than the pessimism. It's not a rational belief, it's just a belief, that at least one should try to be to propose something, or at least try to suggest a way out. So we'll end with this kind of I think more propositive observations. And I think that one thing we should ask ourselves at the beginning of this discussion is, well, what is the status of commons in Western legal culture? Another way of asking the same question is, what is the status of property in Western legal culture? And these two things are, of course, intimately connected. What makes lawyers, jurists, so indifferent towards the growing literature about the commons? Is it because jurists are simply not curious people? Worse things have been said about lawyers, of course, than that. So that might be one explanation, but I don't think that's a major explanation. What is it in the way lawyers and jurists operate which makes them resistant to the idea of the commons? And the final question, is there any way out of this impasse? Are we stuck? And if we are stuck, I suggest that we have a big problem, because then we need to do something about it. Again, law is a very powerful tool, or has at least the potential of being a very powerful tool for social change. And if we, as we might, want to achieve social change, perhaps in the direction of the commons, because we think that the commons may be an interesting paradigm for social change, then the question becomes, how can we get the jurists on board? And I want to start with the first question. What is actually the status of the commons in the discourse of Western legal culture? And I will start this telling you a few things about how law has been shaped, how we got where we are. And I'm, of course, making some generalizations. I will provide a few examples. But as a matter of generalization, we could say that Western legal culture gets in its current shape approximately during the 19th century. Especially private law. I'm leaving constitutional law, public law a little bit aside, but when we discuss the most ancient, most resilient part of Western legal culture, private law, which is the branch of law, for instance, which considers contracts, which considers property, and so on and so forth, that part of the law has clearly been shaped in most of Western Europe during the 19th century. What do I mean when I say it has been shaped? It might be a confusing kind of picture. I mean that the central concepts, what the lawyer mean when the lawyer says the word property, what the lawyer mean when the lawyer says the word contract, and so on and so forth, the systematization of the different subjects, the way they are interrelated to each other, the way the concepts are organized, has very much taken its current shape in the 19th century. Now, as you well know, the 19th century is everything but an ideological neutral time in our history. The 19th century is the age in which the bourgeois revolutions at the end of the 18th century really become ingrained in society. You have the shaping of what I would like to call the bourgeois ideology. And when I say bourgeois ideology, I mean a set of beliefs which sustained a specific social group. And I will show you in just a second that the idea of property, and not any idea of property, but the idea of individual property, the idea of exclusive property, became one of the foundations of that society during the 19th century. And that idea was incorporated in law. So I ask you to think of law, just for a second, as a sort of frozen lake. Not completely frozen. There are some movements under the surface. This ice is slowly moving around. But the general shape of the ice has its origins in the 19th century, and the shape of the ice is the shape of bourgeois ideology. Certain ideas which we connect with liberal democracy, for instance, the idea of individualism, the idea of will as a way of determining a contract. Those ideas, the idea of the subject of law, the idea that law should be neutral from the perspective of your birth. Of course, you know very well that during the Middle Ages, during the Ancien Régime, your possibilities as a human being were very much determined by your birth, by your status. Of course, one could say, well, to a huge extent, that's still true. But what happens during the bourgeois revolutions is that, at least in theory, your possibilities to act, your possibilities to grow economically, your possibilities to succeed, get disentangled from your birth and gets transferred to your possibility to move economically on the market through contracts. You could also put it in another way, the rise of capitalism as a way of restructuring economic relationships has its legal brother in the restructuring of private law. And I will get you a few examples of this, very few, but just to give you a short idea of what I mean, taken from both the civil law tradition — with the civil law tradition I mean the tradition of continental Europe — and from the common law tradition, the tradition of England and the United States. Well, first, what happens during this transformative time in the civil law tradition in continental Europe? Well, first of all, there is a very important transition when it comes to property. The feudal ages, the Ancien Régime, is characterized by a Germanic — I'm using these words as a simplification. If there is a knowledgeable cultural historian, you could say, well, you're wrong in using these etiquettes. But I use them anyway, these labels, because one can make the history much more complex. But as a matter of simplification, one could say that the feudal system was based on a Germanic way of conceiving property. What do I mean by that? Let's say that this is land, bigger than this book. And let's say that on this land, I have several ways — I can use this land in several ways. I can use this land for cultivating, grain. I can use this land to extract turbary. I can use this land to cut trees. I can use this land in many different ways. The owners of this land — first of all, there were not one owner, but a strata of owners. In the Germanic sense of ownership, you didn't own the land. You owned the different possibilities of using the land. So property was not conceived as a monolith. Property was not conceived as — property on land, I'm talking about, was not conceived as one owner of one piece of land. You, different people, owned different possibilities of using land. And of course, the feudal regime worked exactly like that. I, as a lower-ranked aristocrat, had certain possibility to use this land, but over me I had an overlord, and so on and so forth, until I reach, usually, the king or the emperor. This idea, which is a very, if you wish, uncorporeal way of looking at law, was typical of the Middle Ages, and has, generally, its origins in this Germanic way of conceiving property. The Romans generally did not use the same technique. Romans considered land very much as I consider this bottle. If it's mine, it's mine. You don't own possibilities of use, you own the land. This land is yours and you can do whatever you want with it. you own the land and all of the possibilities of using it. During the end of the feudal age, we have a transition from this Germanic pluralistic, if you wish, way of using land to the monolithic Roman way of using land. Now you could be marveled why Roman? Weren't the Roman all dead by that time? And as you well know, yes, but their legal culture was not. Their legal culture had survived. And at this time, this legal culture starts to have a very practical effect on the way land is used. And of course, this Roman way of conceiving land is sponsored, you could say, for political and economic reasons. You have the physiocrats, a philosophical and economical movement during the 18th century in France, who argue that, well, if one person controls all the land, then this person will invest money on it, and this investment will be more efficient. I'm using much more modern words than the physiocrats did, but that was the general message, and the physiocrats were very influential in France. They were very influential in England as well. So you have a sort of economic argument. Then you have a legal argument, which is a little bit less refined in a sense, because what they say is, can't we got rid of this ancient Germanic law and go back to the glory of Roman law? It was really very much put in that way. And also, can't we get rid of these people who are a weight on the land but do not produce anything? The lord, the overlord, and so on. And of course, this is a period in which the country in question, namely mainly France in this case, is starting to move towards what will become the French Revolution. So these ideas start to be more and more openly discussed, even in legal terms. So this other thing starts to be questioned. In France, as in most of Europe, there were collective rights on, for instance, the so-called vent pâture. Marc Bloch, which you probably know, the French historian, has written marvelous books about, among other things, the vent pâture. And essentially, sorry for the pronunciation, French was never my strong subject. And essentially, this was an institution which allowed the different peasants in the village to carry their cows and cattle on each other's lands when it was not cultivated, to eat each other's grass. So the grass was considered a common property. And this kind of institution, between the 18th century and even more strongly after the revolution, starts to be questioned. In fact, after the revolution, with the Code Civil of 1804, the French legislature actively tries to privatize, not only privatize, but to split these collective rights. And they encourage fences, they encourage closing of these lands. They will prove quite resilient, because we know that vent pâture was used in France at least until 1877. So they will survive a long time. But there is a clear attack in law against them. Let me give you another example of how property, when the revolution has taken place or is taking place, becomes a strong part of the legal infrastructure. I mean property in the sense of exclusive individualistic property. Property is called, in the Declaration of 1789, an inviolable and sacred right. Now, think about this expression. This is a revolution which is essentially an atheistic revolution. This is a revolution which is not particularly fond of God, at least not the God of Christianity, not the traditional God of the Bible, but they are attributing some notion of sacredness, of religiosity, to property. And why, one could ask? Well, it's the reasoning is pretty simple if you think about it. What was one of the big problems with the ancien regime? Well, of course, the fact that your destiny as a human being was determined by your birth, by your status. Either you were an aristocrat, or you were a bourgeois, or you were a peasant, or you were a member of the clergy. Your destiny in life was determined by that, by birth. Property is seen as a way of liberation. Property is seen as a way for a human being to take control over his own existence. So in that sense, this enthusiasm can be understood if historically contextualized. And if we look at what happens in the Code Civil of France. The Code Civil of France is one of the big monuments of Western legal writing. The Code Civil of France is still operating, it's still there, it's still valid. It has been for 212 years. It was drafted during Napoleon by a commission of four French legal scholars. What is interesting with the legal, with the Code of France is that it really changes the way law is thought about in not only in France, but in continental Europe, because the Code wants to do something very specific. It wants to cut the tie of law with the Middle Ages. It wants to cut the ties of law with the past. It wants to renew law completely. So it's particularly significant that Article 544 of the Code, when talking about property, says that it's the right of using and disposing of things in the most absolute way. Now, think about this expression. This is a very linguistically precise and actually elegant code, in the sense that this code was so elegant that Stendhal, the French writer, used to read a page of it every night to improve his own French. So it's honestly a literary masterpiece. But think of this expression: the right to use and dispose of things in the most absolute way. Now, I learned in school that you cannot be more or less absolute than anything else. So this is obviously a poetic expression. In the most absolute way, simply very, very, very absolute. This is in a piece of legislation. If you look at the code in general, it's built on three different books. The first book is called On Persons and Family, and it's about wills and marriages and so forth, but the other two books are on the acquisition of property and on the transformation of property. So the whole Code Civil basically rests on the idea of property. And if you think that the Code Civil was called at that time and is still called the Civil Constitution of France, in fact it has endured much, much longer than any of the constitutions of France, you understand how ingrained the idea of property is in the legal grammar of the 19th century. And trust me, this thing continued. These ideas that I'm putting forward here, while they have been criticized by legal theoreticians, legal philosophers, why, of course, we have had two world wars and we have the building of the welfare state, and so on and so forth. But the basic grammar that I'm discussing, the idea that there is one subject of law and his subjectivity is not dependent on his status, the idea that property is exclusive, that one person has control over his property, over his land, the idea that you are perfectly free to contract with anybody and sell this land because it's yours, this basic grammar of private law has not changed very much. It's still pretty much there. And it gets shaped in this time. If we go to the common law, well, there you have a slightly different mechanic because the law in England and the United States works in a different way. It's much more centered around the work of the courts, of the judges, but still you have an even earlier development in the same directions. Let me give you a few examples, very, very few. You have the Gatewards case in 1607, where the court says, well, you know, parishes, villages have no right to have collective rights. They cannot have collective rights. They must be restricted. You have Dean and Chapter of Ely versus Warren in 1741, who denies a very ancient right of a village to extract turbary from private land. You have Warledge versus Manning, 1786, particularly cruel case, because this was a case which pertained to a very ancient tradition which existed in England and existed in France and all over the continent, which was the tradition that when the fields had been, when you cut down the grains from the fields, it's called? Sorry? Yeah, not plow, because plow is, then how do you harvest? Thank you. After the harvest, there was a traditional right for the villagers, for the poor, to go and pick the few things that have been left on the ground, just to make a soup or to make some bread. This was a traditional right. In 1786, this right is denied by a court. You cannot do that. Why? Because this is not your land. It's the land of the lord, of the landlord, the owner of the land. And of course, in 1765, you have Blackstone. And Blackstone gives this extraordinary definition, which is really one of the most quoted definitions in not only American legal literature, so not only Anglo-American legal literature, but even political literature. Even Madison in the United States quoted this in the federal papers. There is nothing which so generally strikes the imagination, just that, and engages the affections of mankind as the right of property. First of all, would you subscribe to that? That is nothing. I mean, when I read it the first time, I had an evil thought. This man cannot have had a particularly interesting life. Or that sole and despotic dominion which one man claims and exercises over the external things of the world, in total exclusion of the right of any other individual in the universe. Now you must realize that this Blackstone, this is not any kind of, this is the most read author in the whole history of English law. He was so read that 17 of the subscribers of the Declaration of Independence had a copy of his book. Most American lawyers at that time learned English law through Blackstone. He was incredibly popular writer. So this definition gives you a taste, not of what English law was at the time, because to be fair to English law at the time, there was a lot of collective rights still in place in 1765. This gives you an idea of what they were aiming for. So in this transformative period for European, in general, Western legal culture, this is the mentality, both in France, as we saw, and in the Anglo-Saxon world. And I could give you examples from other countries, but these are perhaps the two most influential. There is an interesting counterexample, I call it. Why? Because this demonstrates that an other world was possible. And in Scandinavia, if you go to Scandinavia, as I did, very, very early you discover that things are a little bit different. First of all, when I looked for a definition of property, because in German law, in Italian law, in France law, in English law even, there are definitions of property. In Swedish law, there is no definition of property. There is no definition of property in the Constitution. There is no definition of property in any legislation. And if you open a book about private law, the pages devoted to property are very, very few. This is not to say that Sweden or Scandinavia in general is completely outside of the mold of Western law. Of course, it's still a tradition which reveres individualism. It's still a tradition which reveres productivity in the sense of capitalist productivity and so on and so forth. But because of historical accidents, which I will not bore you with right now because they're not fully relevant for our discussion, property didn't become this almost sexy legal feature that we saw. I mean, no Scandinavian has ever said that. That phrase could not be, if you told the Scandinavians to say it, he would refuse, because it's not really in the mentality. Property is not very important politically as it was in England and in France. And there has been some practical results of that in our time. One result, I could argue, is what I told you at the beginning of this lecture, namely the allemansrätt, the fact that people are generally allowed to walk on each other's land without damaging, without invading each other's privacy, and so on and so forth. But you see some striking difference between how Scandinavians perceive property and how continental Europeans and also the common law perceives property. So Scandinavia can work as a sort of demonstration a contrario. You see, if you really take property out of the equation, interesting things happen in our time. Of course, I could multiply the examples of the influence of property and the influence of these bourgeois categories on the law, and I could convince you even more, if I have not already convinced you, that the 19th century really saw the rise of these notions. But this would not explain why things have not changed. Okay, you could say, well, law did get this shape in the 19th century. Why didn't it change again? I mean, of course, you could say, well, the influence of bourgeois ideology was very widespread. It was very widespread all over European culture, I would say by definition of the word ideology. So why did the lawyers, why were lawyers influenced for a much longer time than anybody else? Why are they still under the spell of bourgeois ideology? What makes them stuck? We need, I think, some specific explanatory models which take into account the specific way law operates. And one first step into that direction is to take into account one of the bigger divides in discussing how law changes and how law develops. And a little bit cheeky, I have speaking here about mirror theories and bubble theories. You could say that, well, I wrote a reflection with a K, very Swedish of me, so it's of course a reflection with a C, but the major question is law in our society, in whatever society you live, is law a reflection of that society, of that culture, or of part of that society, part of that culture, or is law something autonomous? And I think that for most scholars historically have adhered to some form of mirror theory. Law is, if not the reflection of society as a whole, at least the reflection of some specific feature in society. Law has been considered the reflection of economics. Law has been considered the reflection of the interests of the ruling elites. Law has been considered the reflection of the values of that people, and so on and so forth. And there are plenty of theoreticians and scholars who have espoused this kind of view. Most famously, Savigny. Savigny was, I don't know if you're if you know him, he's probably more famous in my circles than out of them, but Savigny was a Prussian scholar who really compared law to language. And his political attempt was to avoid a codification, to avoid to write down, you could say, German law in a code as they had done in France. And in arguing against codification, in arguing against writing down the law, he was saying, well, the law is like language. The law is a cultural expression, not just a technical expression. Law changes with society. Law should be allowed to freely change with society. Therefore, we should not put it in a cage. We should not put it in a solid written form. Of course, when he was saying, he also said that law was essentially governed by the Volksgeist, the spirit of the people. Of course, if you read in between the lines, when he said people, he meant legal scholars, and when he meant legal scholars, he meant essentially himself, because he was a Prussian aristocrat. But nonetheless, this is a typical example of a mirror theory. Pierre Legrand is, among the living scholars, the most staunch defender of this idea, the idea that law is actually, he's even saying, well, you cannot educate yourself to be an English lawyer. You are born to be an English lawyer. You absorb English values through your mother's milk, and then when you become a lawyer, you live out those values in the law. And then you have the main bubble theory, which I find convincing, at least if taken with a grain of salt. And the main bubble theoreticians, it's my word, bubble. No, don't use it outside of this room because they would not recognize what you're saying. The main bubble theoretician is Alan Watson. Alan Watson is a Scottish legal historian. And he very cleverly dedicated his huge part of his scholarship to so-called legal transplants. He was interested in seeing how different legal systems borrow rules from each other and change while borrowing rules. He also made a few very insightful, at least from my perspective, studies about Roman law. And his main point was, well, you know, all people are exaggerating the connection between society and law. Law is not living in society, law is in a bubble. At least not a completely closed bubble. There are obvious connections between law and society. We know that political majorities, for instance, can create legislation. That's an obvious connection with society. But lawyers as a community, those who actually debate legal concepts, those they live in a bubble. And he made an interesting example to explain this. He said, well, for instance, as many say, law is an expression of the power of the ruling elite, then we would expect, if that's always the case, we would expect a swift change of the law as soon as the interests of the power elites change. And his study in Roman law demonstrates very convincingly that that's not the case. And let me give you an example of one of his findings. He studied, for instance, the Institute of Patria Potestas, which was essentially the rule in Rome saying that a living father had full power over his sons, even his adult sons, even a 40-year-old son. Not only that, that father owned everything. The son owned nothing. The son started owning things only when the father died. And if that was at a very late age, so be it. Caesar didn't own a penny. And he argues with good historical examples that, well, that was not very convenient for the Roman ruling elite. And many rules at the time were not very convenient, but they endured for centuries. Why? Because, Alan Watson says, and this I have to read because it's, I think it's a telling, it's a very good description of what I'm trying to say. Law is treated by jurists, this is important, so when he's speaking about the treatment of law by insiders, as existing in its own right. Law exists in its own right. It is being in conformity with lawness that makes law law. Another way of putting it is law is circular. Lawyers look to law to find law. They live, at least partially, in a circular, closed world. Hence, first the means of creating law, the sources of law. In our culture, the source of law are legislation, cases by the judiciary, and so on and so forth. In some cultures, even legal scholarship is a source of law. Come to be regarded as a given, they are not questioned. Secondly, law has to be justified in its own terms. Law is justified by its own logic, one could say. Hence, authority has to be sought and found. You cannot make a legal reasoning without authority. That authority, in some form, which may be perverted, he concedes, must already exist. Hence, law is typically backward-looking. And this makes law inherently conservative. Now, this is a point which I need to devote a couple of minutes to because it's important, especially because I think none of here is a lawyer. I think I'm the only one. Make me feel lonely. But to understand this, you need to understand how law operates. Let me give you an historical example which I think makes things pretty clear, hopefully. When does the modern, the current tradition of law start in Europe? In continental Europe, at least. It starts approximately in the 11th century when a university, University of Bologna in Italy, rediscovers Roman law. Essentially, they rediscover a particular collection of rules called the Corpus Juris Civilis of Justinian. This book, this collection of rules, had been compiled in the 6th century BC. So it was already 5 centuries old. It's the same thing as if I said, guys, let's rule our society, let's regulate our society inspired by law from the 16th century. You would not agree to that. So why did these Italian scholars start to analyze Roman law? Why were they so successful? Roman law spread all over Europe. It became the main paradigm of legal studies during the Middle Ages. A, because there was not a better alternative than Roman law. But B, because Roman law carried authority. When we see how these scholars work, they always look at what Watson is writing there, that authority in some form which might be perverted. yes, they did often pervert the words of the Roman book in order to better fit these rules to their society, which was, of course, 500 years younger. But why did they then use this book? Why didn't they simply get on a table and write rules, the best rules they could conceive? Why did they need to go back to Roman scholars? Why did they need to go back to the words of emperors who had died centuries before and whose empires in the meantime have crumbled? Because they needed authority. That's one true constant in all of law. Lawyers reasons from authority. That makes law, as Watson says, looking backward. We are always looking for some form of something to use as a pinpoint for our to sustain our arguments. There is another way of looking at this argument, which I think is also pretty interesting, which is the idea of legal ideology. And it's an idea which emerges in the so-called legal realist movement. It was a movement of the first half of the 20th century. And it was a movement which developed in two places, essentially, the United States and Scandinavia. Why these two specific places is a very interesting question, not adequately answered. But it's interesting to understand what these scholars reacted about against. They reacted exactly against what Alan Watson is describing. Basically, they say law is formalistic. Law has become a sort of celebration of its own concepts. Law is, I'm simplifying a little bit, but I think this is the core message. And they wanted to conceive law as social engineering. They wanted to reconceive law as a way of designing new institutions rather than simply relying on old authority, on old concepts. And the two authors which say it in the most convincing way are the Swedish scholar Wilhelm Lundstedt, who's actually coins this expression legal ideology. And with legal ideology, he means exactly the idea that lawyers creates concepts, and with time these concepts are treated as objective natural facts. Let me give an example of this. His one main criticism of Scandinavian legal realism is, for instance, against property. Well, they say, what does it mean to be an owner of something? They argue, for most lawyers, when you say, Joe owns that particular land, that means a sort of metaphysical, it's an expression for a sort of metaphysical power. Joe, by buying the land, has acquired a sort of metaphysical property, which we called being an owner or property, and this metaphysical property then has some consequences in the real world. And Wilhelm Lundstedt say, well, that's not what is occurring here. When you own land, you are not changed as a human being to an owner, which is the way lawyers unconsciously think about it. What is happening is that a series of psychological effects is taking place in yourself and in the outside world. So if I am an owner, the only difference between me being an owner and you being a non-owner is that I can use the land and I will not have any psychological restraint. Another important factual difference is that if you enter the land and start cutting trees, I can call the cops and you cannot. But the difference are very real. Either there are difference in the head, the psychology of the people involved. If you are a non-owner and enter my land, you might be educated by your family, by your society, to either not do it because you're not the owner, or you might be educated, if you are a thief, to disguise yourself and try to get away. But this is what the point of Lundstedt is, let's not confuse concepts which we have created culturally, which we have constructed, with reality. This may seem, and probably is, completely banal to you, but if you come from a world of lawyers in which these concepts have been, as Watson say, used circularly for centuries, and nothing of this has been discussed, you realize that as soon as you stop considering abstract concepts as existing in the world, and you start seeing them as social constructs, you can also start thinking of how can I change them? How can I redesign them? And that was the ambition of Lundstedt. Let's get rid of legal ideology, of this sophistication, this preposterous idea that there is something called property out there, and let's understand that there is something called property in here. And if it is in here, then it can be changed. And Roberto Mangabeira Unger, which is instead a American-Brazilian scholar, much later in the critical legal theory movement, he writes in a book in the 90s called What Should Legal Analysis Become, that the main problem with law today is that lawyers are simply incrementalists. They polish one, he says with humor, well, every lawyer thinks that 95% of the law is perfectly fine, but there is a 5% which could be polished, 5% which could be made even more coherent, even more precise, and that's what we do. But we never redesign law. And that's partially, Unger argues, because when we say lawyer in law schools, in education, we don't say, the figure, the archetypical figure of lawyer we think of is the judge. And he says, well, why should the judge be the archetype? Could we not think of a lawyer who is, in fact, a reformer? Someone working in legislation, someone there to design legal institutions. So basically say, let's try to use law for fostering what he calls institutional imagination. Let's do democratic experimentalism. And all these things might seem pretty foreign to all of you. But again, you live in a world which is pretty different from mine in a sense that in the world of law, as Watson tried to describe, everything is self-referential to a certain point. You can think of a sort of spiral. It goes in some direction, but around and around. It changes everything a little bit in close circles, which means that why are not commons in the radar of lawyers, essentially? Because commons in the last 200 years have not been, there's no authority using the word commons. There's no scholar using the word commons. Or at least there has not been a scholar until now. What is the great exception? Intellectual property, which means essentially the property related to the products of your mind, movies, pictures, music, and so on and so forth. Why do they use the word commons? Digital commons, for instance, knowledge commons, and so on and so forth. Because they were confronted with a crisis, and the crisis was the internet. Once you can spread knowledge digitally from a phone to a computer and from a computer to a phone, it's pretty obvious that you need something that the old legal paradigms cannot be used. And this gives me some measure of hope, because this shows, and there are many historical examples, that actually lawyers can be shaken out of this spiral. They can be shaken out of this if the surrounding conditions becomes bad enough. The problem is that what is a condition bad enough which might make lawyers take notice of commons? Well, that's a matter of speculation, but it could be a major, an even bigger environmental crisis than the one we are witnessing right now. It might be an even bigger political crisis than the one we are witnessing right now. To be fair, something is happening in law. So I must be fair to my colleagues. First of all, in Italy, one of my two countries, things have happened. A few years ago, there was a referendum on water rights, which was won by those who wanted water rights to stay common, and it was won using commons as a major political word. And one of the major masterminds behind the referendum was a legal scholar, Ugo Mattei, who is also one of the persons behind another important idea, the idea of beni comuni, common goods, which in its own turn have influenced the Italian Supreme Court. So things are happening. I have tried with my modest means to spread these kind of concepts in Sweden, and I have had some good fortune. Now a fellow scholar is publishing a book about the commons and inspired by our conversation. So I am, in that sense, pretty, at least I'm more optimistic than I was a few years ago. And then there is another fact that, which I think lawyers rarely think about. The formalism, the circularity of law, can also be used to our advantage, in the sense that if you take the time to construct the notion of commons, indicating that there are several phenomena out there that fall into that category. For instance, in the case of Sweden, it would be the allemansrätt, which I talked about, is a clear case of commons. The Sami right of reindeering in northern Sweden is another phenomenon who falls under the category of commons. If you are a classic formalistic scholar, what you could do is say, well, see, here we have different specific phenomena. Well, let's abstract them to a general concept, the concept of commons. And if that concept becomes legitimized in the legal discourse, then it can be reused over time and enter into the spiral. So what I suggest is that the spiral is not completely closed. It actually can be manipulated by intellectual means. Thank you very much. That was all that I had.